Good evening. My name is Michał Iwanicki. I'm a physiotherapist, acupuncturist, and future osteopath, I think, and a founder of this here channel, YouTube channel, that is called in Polish Droga Środka and in English, The Middle Way. Since more than 1 year, I publish videos on my channel concerning Chinese medicine, but also osteopathy and physiotherapy. And it was always my dream to have people coming to this channel to interview them, health professionals, but not only, to speak about their professional in a way, about how they treat their patients, about the philosophy in which they are working with, the method in which they are working with. My first guest here is a person that is very, I'm very fond of, is my greatest teacher of all so far in terms of Chinese medicine. He is one of the first, I think, licensed acupuncturist in US, isn't it?
Yep. Yeah.
With over 52 years experience, Chinese medicine doctor and bachelor in science, that's right?
Right.
Yeah. Founder of Lingshu Institute, assistant of Dr. Chou Yan So, or better known as James Tin Yao So, from 74 to 84, co-author of 6th and 7th edition of Compendium of Chinese Medicine in Germany, president of Acupuncture Foundation of New England for 7 years, in the past, of course, senior faculty member, co-director of the New England School of Acupuncture from 77 to 80, founding member of regional vice president of both the National Acupuncture Association and the American Association of Acupuncture and Oriental Medicine, founding member of the Acupuncture Detox Unit of the Boston Mayor's Coordination Council and Drug Abuse, and the Acupuncture Detox Unit of the Massachusetts Mental Health Department. I have to get used to speaking
that's
English,
all right.
You know.
That's all right. There's, you know, I think we can stop there.
Okay. You think? Okay. Donald Halfkenny.
Hello,
nice
Michal.
To meet you. Hello.
It's good seeing you. Good seeing you again. Good seeing you again.
We met, I think it was about 2014 or 15, something like this. And it was a very special time for me. I was looking for my way in Chinese medicine. I was kind of confused where to look. I'm always thinking about kind of integrate this work into my practice also as a physiotherapist, working using hands and so on. And I never got quite all the answers from the teachers that that taught me. But I met you. I went on the supervision, and it was amazing for me what happened there with patients and how you work. And we will get into that later on. But first, I would like to ask you, how did you start with Chinese medicine? I mean, what is your way in Chinese medicine? How did it start?
Well, it basically started. Thank you for the question, first of all, and the opportunity to share some of that. My path in Chinese medicine sort of happened because other paths that I had chosen initially were all of a sudden closed to me. It wasn't possible to continue my studies. It wasn't possible to maintain the direction that I originally planned. And I came in contact with some people that were working in the drug abuse field, which I at that point was already working in. And there was a conference about current and alcohol addiction in New York. It was put on by the Einstein School of Medicine, where there were two physicians, one from Vietnam, the other from Hong Kong, that talked about the use of Chinese medicine, acupuncture, in terms of detoxing people or helping people to detox from heroin from alcohol. And also based on the problems that people have who were addicted, who are now clean, in terms of regular medical care, concerning pain issues or operations where they are then re-exposed to medicine that is opiate-based, which means that the potential for them getting re-addicted or having, a fall is greater because there was no alternative. And that was just for me, all of a sudden it was like, that's what I want to do. There were
What
other things involved. There were other things involved with, but
how many years
these.
have you had at that time?
What do you mean, how many years?
I mean, how old were you?
Oh, that's a good question. Let me, I have to run back for a second. Let's see. We started 1970s, 70, 1970. So what was that? 23.
Nice.
No, it was 23, 22, 23. When I met, that's when I started working clinically. I wasn't yet doing acupuncture in the way in which I did it later. It started with ear acupuncture based on the work from the Nanjing Army Medical Unit. They put out a book on ear acupuncture, which since
Okay.
then I had loaned to someone and never seen again. Which happens, people fall in love with material that they borrow and they forget that it's not theirs. Or they, what's worse is when they pass it on to someone else because it's so exciting and then they don't get it back. That happens as well.
I mean,
But
if they hold it for long enough, is it's theirs, you
I understand that. I mean,
know.
that exists also in English law, in American law. Possession is 9/10 of the law. That's what they say. In any event, that's when I began to realize that, acupuncture was a possibility in terms of supporting people in this process. My ex-wife was a counselor in a program and was also interested in finding ways to deal with the issue around methadone, because methadone had become in Boston and New York the biggest answer to heroin addiction. What we knew is that methadone meant that people would become addicted to methadone and the health issues were greater than if they were just addicted to heroin. But it was a control issue. The government, the health industry in New York, as well as Massachusetts, and the legal structure said, well, we'll give people methadone, but only if they come for therapy. But because methadone was stronger and had a stronger and longer effect than heroin, it was attractive for people who were addicted. So they came with methadone, which meant they came to the therapy, which meant they would then get their methadone. The arguments that they were using were that if methadone is government controlled, then street crime becomes less. Drugs are not sold on the
Okay.
streets. People are. None of which turned out to be true. But that's a separate issue. In any event, methadone had been developed originally by the Department of Defense in the United States as a substitute for opiates in terms of pain issues. 1954, they stopped using it because of the side effects. So one of the side effects was sterility. Another side effects was permanent damage to the liver and to the kidneys. And they decided based on that, and the fact that withdrawal was a lot more serious than it was for heroin. And based on that, they discontinued using it. Someone rediscovered it, and thought that it would be the perfect answer for the opiate problem in the United States, and that it would enable the authorities to control the addicts as well as reduce street crime through the legal distribution of methadone.
Okay.
But because we knew what the health issues were, we were looking for another answer. We were looking for a permanent answer for people. And
And
based
ear
on,
acupuncture was working for that.
ear acupuncture was one of the things that at that point had become interesting. There was a group under Dr. Michael Smith. Mike and my wife, my ex-wife, knew each other in Virginia. Both came from Virginia. Because they'd studied not with each other, but they were in the university at the same time. And he was involved in a methadone clinic in Einstein School of Medicine and had, through Dr. Pomerantz in Toronto, begun using ear acupuncture and body acupuncture to work with addicts. But it wasn't yet as a substitute. It was, first of all, what works, what doesn't work. In any event, through all of that, and through the cooperation that we then had with each other, I became more and more and more interested and involved in acupuncture, not just ear acupuncture, and came in contact with two physicians who had been professors in China, Kenneth Chuang and Yvonne Chen. And they were actually my first teachers. And in a short period of time, we reached a point where they said, well, if you really want to go deep, you have to get in touch with this person, with Dr. So. He is
Okay.
now in the United States.
And he
And make
lived
a long.
in the United States.
Well, he had just come to the United States.
Okay.
He had left China, had gone to Japan and Malaysia, worked as a missionary, then came to the United States, was in California, then in Maryland, and then came to Massachusetts,
Okay.
where I finally met him.
It was really surprising for me because in Europe he was not so famous, but when you told me about him, I read his books and they are really great. I mean, they are like compendium of Chinese medicine, you know.
Yeah, he is considered to be the father of American acupuncture.
Okay.
There are two other acupuncturists that were active around the same time on the West Coast. Was Maxime, I think, and Miriam Lee. And they're actually more well known in the meantime. Though at that point, Dr. So was he'd been invited by Stephen Rosenblatt and a couple of other people who had met him in Hong Kong to come to the United States and work in a research project in the beginning, which was very short-lived. And he then left California and went to Maryland, then basically came to Boston. Let me think for a second. So when I met him, he'd been in the United States for a year and a half. It was 2 years. And he'd been in Boston by that time for 6 months, I think. And these two physicians, these two acupuncturists, these two doctors, said, if you really want to do this, that's where you have to, he's the one you have to get in touch with, because we cannot teach you anymore than what we've already taught. But if you want to go deeper, he's the man. So this is okay, good. And make a long story short, after meeting him, it was clear to me that what he did, I had no idea. I mean, it was totally, completely different from anything that I'd experienced. In terms of the needle insertion, it was totally painless. The effect was immediate. He operated on different levels at the same time. Though he didn't talk about any of that, at that moment, but it was obvious, feeling what was going on was just very different than anything I'd experienced up until that point in time. He did not use air acupuncture, not because he didn't believe in it, but because the classical techniques that he used were more than sufficient. I mean, if he needed to do it, he would, just like with herbs, if he needed to, or felt it was helpful for the patient because they needed to be able to take something between treatments, he would prescribe herbs, but primarily it was acupuncture. And what I learned later is that his teacher and his teacher's teacher were very famous. There's a special lineage in Chinese medicine. And he belonged to that lineage. He was the only, he was the last of the line, so to speak.
So when you are saying lineage, is a master and student, right? Not
that's
a,
right.
Like a family.
Well, no, it was also a family situation. The father of his master's master and the father of his master, both of them practiced that and passed it on. But it was, it's just the tradition of Tang Shen Ming, of one needle acupuncture is what we called it in English, is a very old treatment system based on the classical text. And that's what they did. That was a family tradition that was passed on. And he was not a member of the family. He was just he was a student that became the main pupil of his master. So he was given the responsibility of passing that on, basically. And so, you know, all of a sudden we had a school. He had started with the form, New England School of Acupuncture, before I met him, but the structure and the form of the school was different, and that changed over the period of years. That was part of the process that I was involved in. That's why we say sometimes that the school, even though it exists, was founded in 1975, 1976, even though it exists in 1974.
Okay. And it was in New England, right?
Yeah, it was New England. It was the school was in Watertown. It's just outside of, it's a small town that borders on Cambridge and Boston. And originally the first classes happened in his basement, which was around the corner from where I was born in Boston. He lived in Boston originally. And then in a factory, an old factory building, we had some rooms, and then we ended up having the whole floor for the school, with a classroom and kitchen and, you know, library and a place where people could, you know, practice Qigong or Tai Chi or whatever.
Nice.
Yeah, but that was a developmental process.
I remember when you, on some occasion, you told me, or you told on the course, how you met Dr. So, that you were, you know, searching for him, and he wasn't there. Then you were driving for other
That's
cities.
Right. Yeah, he wasn't. It didn't matter what town or what city, what part of the country I was in when I was looking for him. That isn't where he was. You know, when I finally gave up looking for him, and came back and talked to my teachers, they said, you know, they started laughing and said, "Yep," to which I didn't understand, and they were laughing because he was in Boston. You know, so that, I mean, that happens sometimes. You know, if you, when you stop looking for, you know, and you're able to sort of be still and wait to see what comes, more often than not, that's when you get the information you need. And that's what happened. You know, there was no place else to look for him. I didn't know where else to look, so I stopped looking. And he was around the corner.
And he was speaking some English, or was it only Chinese?
No, I was speaking English. His English was not bad. His English was not bad. I mean, there were some things that were difficult in terms of writing. If you look at, I still have a copy of the first notes that we put together for the first book that we published. My sister, brother-in-law, and myself published the first book of his material in English.
Nice.
Well, I have it. Hold on, I'll show it to you. This is it.
Okay, I have the red one.
Yeah, but those are different. Those were published a lot later. This is the
Okay.
first one. This was done on an offset press.
Wow, nice.
Yeah, we did it by hand. Wait a minute. Let's see. We published this in 1977.
Nice.
Yeah. Well, and these are the before we published it. This was the form that it had.
I cannot see it.
Okay, we
So
haven't. Well,
okay.
you know, what?
Nice.
Of course, you can't see it because it's on the back. It's the
Yeah.
wrong side. I'm sorry. This is the
Okay.
form that we had. There was really each page was then done by hand. We photographed it, Xeroxed it, did it with a photo offset, corrected. This is the one that has the corrections in it before we made the final publication. Oh no, we bound it together. And this is what the first students got before the other book was published.
Nice.
And then the black one was published, and then it was a couple of years where there was nothing published until I left the United States. I think Bob Felt and Martha Fielding. From Red Wing Publishers had then got permission to publish the first series, and then there was another series after that was published. But it's basically the same information. The difference is the foreword, the introduction, they changed a little bit. And in the last publication, do I have a copy of that someplace? I don't think so. The last publication starts out with what is claimed to be an interview with him, but I know from the wording that there's a little bit of poetic license involved in the writing that the publishers did at the moment. But just so it's clear, his first book, and that's basically five books of his. Because he wrote five books. They're all in that one volume. And that was 1977. After that, it was always published as a two-volume piece, a red one and a white one. One was points and the other was treatment.
And how was it? How was because what Dr. James Saw was
Dr.
doing
So.
was oh yeah Dr. Saw was doing had a term of classical acupuncture, right or not? And how is it different than TCM?
Okay. TCM exists in terms of traditional Chinese medicine, or TCM acupuncture exists basically only since 1934.
That's right.
Okay. So that's the first difference. The second is that it is based on a development that happened because of the embargo that was imposed on China after the communists took over, where the United States, Great Britain, France prevented medical supplies and doctors and help to the indigenous Chinese citizens because
Oh, okay.
it was now a communist country. So it was necessary to find a way to provide ongoing health care that was local. And because of the only other Western-oriented medical care that was available was based on what the Japanese had done before, they looked more and more and more toward their own indigenous
Heritage.
medical tradition.
Yeah.
you know, in terms of herbs, in terms of acupuncture, in terms of Tai Chi, in terms of tuina and mo, in terms of, you know, using, you know, stones. They looked at all of that in the beginning, and there were four physicians. Think for a second. Cheng Tan An, who was the master of my master. Qinbo Wei, who was mainly an herbalist. And the other two names I don't remember, I'm sorry. But those four physicians were given the responsibility to redesign or rejuvenate the Chinese medical profession. And part of that meant looking at the different classical traditions with herbs as well as with acupuncture and making a unified approach out of all of that.
So this unified approach was TCM?
That was TCM.
Okay.
They called it the traditional Chinese medicine because it was based on different traditions, but it's not traditional in the way in which we would use that in the West. In the West, yeah. Traditional means that it's based on the roots. It has to do with, you know, okay, the original. And in this form, because that happened under the communist regime, it meant that certain aspects of classical Chinese medicine were left out. They were considered to be not ideologically correct. They used a different concept of Shen, for example, which does not include any aspect of the divine or any transcendental aspect and concept of an existence or an instance that is more than just a material presentation.
Because this is the way which it goes in countries with communist system, right?
That's right.
No spirit, no God, no...
Well, yeah, spirit for them is different. Spirit has to do with attitude, emotion, you know, charisma, the way in which people think. But in terms of spiritual aspect that we are...
That's right.
Yeah, that doesn't exist. That doesn't exist. And what that did is it emasculated, as far as I'm concerned, a lot of aspects of Chinese medicine and acupuncture, because it meant that there were certain things, including the way in which people looked at life, that were no longer possible to explain or for people to address. Mm-hmm. The concept of heaven, mankind on earth had to do more with a physical structure. It didn't have to do with the different aspects and different qualities of the influences that are responsible for life existing. Mm-hmm. So, of course, things like, if you say, which, you know, people learn in their classes, you know, that the heart is the absolute authority. And if you read the classical text, you see the heart has two main aspects. One is as emperor and the other is as master. And the emperor is the divine or the spiritual manifest in the person. And that's responsible for controlling and determining how everything functions. And the master is the way in which that information is translated to the other structures and processes in the body, but that the heart is an organ without form. It's only function. There's no form. The heart, if you have only a materialist way of looking at things, how do you apply those two aspects in a clinical setting? It doesn't work. What does work is the Nanjing approach in terms of the five phases or five elements or five seasons, looking at the heart as heart fire, kaizen, emperor fire, ministerial fire. That's at the lowest level, mm-hmm. if you will. That's at the level of five. It's not at the level of one or at the level of two, in terms of dealing with the way in which the classics describe the role of the heart in the clinical process. So that's a core difference between traditional Chinese medicine and classical Chinese medicine. That in the classical Chinese medicine, this aspect plays a central role.
I have a funny story with that, because the first movies that I created for my channel One of the first was about traditional Chinese medicine, and it was like a 10 or 13 minute movie about how it's different, and that it was sort of created during communist times, of course, sort of, because it was the data collected from before and some of the things left out. And basically what you can also read about, it's mainly on based on the herbal system, right? The acupuncture is herbal. And I can say it also that when I studied in China, I also saw it. And I think mainly the Chinese teachers right now, from what I saw, they are basing their practices on herbs. Like
very much.
Acupuncture are something addition is something additional, you know, but herbs are
essential.
Yeah, essential.
Yeah. Well, that's you have to remember, medicine has to do with taking something internally. Usually when you talk about medicine, you're talking about treating someone from inside with medication of some form, with pills, with herbs. Acupuncture, if you look at, you know, not only do we treat the inside from the outside, but if you look at the original classics, they have a different approach to what life is about. They have a different approach to the way in which they see the treatment process. I mean, one of the most important books in classical acupuncture is the Ling Shu. That's the divine pivot. And it talks about the role at different parts of the divine or the spiritual plays in sickness and in health and how you deal with that. Very different.
What is funny when I made this movie, I don't know if it, you know, it just happened, but like in a half a year, all the practices in Poland changed the names from traditional Chinese medicine to
That's
Chinese
right.
medicine.
Yeah.
Or to classical Chinese medicine.
Yeah, well, that's one of the things that became confusing, because originally, you know, it's very clear people, they had a TCM practice, and some people still do. You know, they still call it that because that's their approach. And it works. It's not that it doesn't work. It's just
That's right.
Different. It has a different basis. The diagnostic processes, the way in which you look at the way in which the different systems in the body function, how they communicate with each other in terms of classical acupuncture is different than in terms of herbal medicine. So
yeah.
The acupuncture based on herbal
because
medicine has a different approach.
Herbal medicine is more, the approach is more about the organs, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I have a question about classical Chinese medicine, because, okay, now everything switched, so the TCM is sort of left behind. Now we have classical, but I can see that there is also some concern here, and there are lots of schools. And the first, I think that I heard about, and I think they call themselves classical Chinese medicine, is five elements. That one from
Worsley,
Great
yeah.
Britain, from Great Britain, right? And now there is very popular this school of stems and branches. And also I heard and I learned something about Japanese medicine, which is also called this classical Chinese. From some people call it classical Chinese medicine, this Japanese one. And there are so many, and then there is what you thought, and there are so many different approaches. And what I'm thinking is that, you know, sometimes I open the Ling Shu, and are they all really based on the classics? This is my first question. And what really is a classic text? Until what time you can call it a classic? And when there is, you know.
Well, let's start at the last one and go back to the first ones.
Yeah.
Classical Chinese medicine and acupuncture is based on five classical texts. Su Wen, Ling Shu, Jia Zhi, Mai Jing, and the Nanjing. Those five. If you have a treatment or diagnostic approach based on all or any one of them, then it fits within the concept of classical Chinese medicine or the classical Oriental medicine, or like Stephen Birch says, classical Far East or traditional Far East medicine. But we have to, if we think historically, we have to be honest and remember that part of classical Chinese medicine, in terms of acupuncture as well as herbs, came from India. And part of it, in terms of development over a period of time, came from Mongolia. Part of it came from the Arab world because, based on the Silk Road, there was a lot of scientific exchange between those different cultures in terms of the pulse diagnosis, for example. There's a book by Ambrose who's very, very good in terms of looking at the different roots of how people look at the pulse from different countries. So when you think of classical Chinese medicine, classical acupuncture, all of those treatment approaches fit into that. They're all part of that. Classical Chinese medicine is very broad, very open. There's a basis that is common, but how people interpret that and use that is really open to their own experience and to their own understanding. That means it's not a hermetically sealed concept. It's not, it's only this, 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 and this, and there's nothing else. What is important in each of those approaches, doesn't matter whether it's stems and branches or five phases, or the five, what people here call five elements, is basically the five seasons, the five changes. What's central for all of them is really, in the classical sense, is an exact clinical approach. And what I mean by that is doesn't mean leaving out certain diagnostic processes. It means that the clinical aspect, the mechanics of the treatment, if you're talking about herbs or if you're talking about acupuncture, is a specific way of doing it as exact as possible. That's always the goal. Because when you if you can do that, then the way in which you interpret the information that you get becomes more reliable. This is simple example is point location. If your point location is exact, then every time you see the same patient, you will be needling the same point. And if you see another patient, you will be needling the same corresponding point on them, an exact place that fits their body structure. Now, if you rely on methods that are sort of, I think it's here or maybe it's there, or you can have an effect on the field that is created by the point, but you don't have the same exactness. You don't have the same ability to fine-tune your treatment. You don't have the same ability to experience the different qualities of qi and blood that flow through that point at different levels. And based on that, for the most part, in terms of TCM acupuncture, or in terms of Japanese acupuncture, and Japanese acupuncture tends to deal more with the level of heaven in terms of the depth of needle insertion. A TCM acupuncture deals more with the level of mankind or life, if you will. And very seldom do either of them, except for pain issues, needle more deeply or affect or come in contact with consciously with these deeper aspects of the process of life in a patient. The classical acupuncture, the style that my teacher, and his teacher used, is one of the things that was important was the needle depth. And it was based on the nature of disease. It was either at the level of heaven, mankind, or earth, three different levels.
Yeah, I
And
even read the just recently I read one of the chapters of Ling Shu. It's called, I think, Nine Needles.
That's right.
And everything is what you are talking is there.
Yeah.
I mean, not everything, but most of it. That it's for me, it's interesting because it's sort of basic stuff. I mean, basic, not easy, but basic stuff. But I think you were the first person to talk about it. And I don't think in any schools right now that call themselves classic, there is this thought about needle manipulation or going into the different levels of the tissue. You know, it's more going, you know, what was your date of birth and what points should we needle? I mean, I'm not saying it's bad. I don't feel it because I like to work with patient that comes to my practice and I see what's going on at this present moment, you know, but, you know,
Yeah, I mean, stems and branches, for example, is a system that works if you know how to use it properly. You know, it's just like anything else. You know, airplanes, fighter jets fly, you know, and they're good at it. But if I don't know how to fly one, it doesn't help me that I have the best fighter jet in the world. You know, one of the things that is true for all schools, it was true for ours as well. You can't teach what you don't know. And knowledge is based on experience and not just based on information. So if the experience isn't there that supports the information and helps you to understand the information differently, then you can't apply it. And if you can't apply it, you can't teach it. You know, then it's just theoretical. And there are systems that are easier to understand. Very simple. One of the things that the Chinese did was to simplify the way in which classical Chinese or Chinese medicine in general, as well as acupuncture, was taught. You know, and they left out the things that were too complicated. It started out with the so-called barefoot doctor movement. And that was very simple, very, very, very simple acupuncture and herbs. And sort of developed from there. Many of the physicians and teachers that had a deeper understanding were either forbidden to work because they had been part of the democratic movement, or they left the country, or they were killed. So you had a period from 1934 to 1950 about, we had to reinvent, in many ways, Chinese medicine and acupuncture at the most basic and simplest level so it could work, because that was important. But so it was not too complicated for people to learn or to put it into practice.
Yeah, but what I think is really difficult, and I reminded myself when you were teaching me that every lesson you had with us, it was about reminding us to read the classics, right? And just now I was getting into Ling Shu, and you know, I read an article from 2022 from Stephen Birch about definition of the word acupuncture. Have you read it?
No.
Well, based on Ling Shu, he and the co-authors, he is saying that the word is not right. that it shouldn't be acupuncture, because even though it's from Latin, acus, the needle, and puncture is to needle, it's not really right, because in Ling Shu, in this chapter of nine needles, you can find that there were some objects that were not needles. I mean, they were not needling, just putting them on the skin. So there was no penetration of the needle, right?
Well, no, in terms of the nine needles, all of the needle techniques are about penetration. It is possible, which you know, based on Ping Shen, based on the work with the heart, to have the needles placed on the skin or touching the skin to have an effect, but that depends on the development and the attitude of the clinician himself. It doesn't just happen automatically. In terms of the translation of the Chinese name for acupuncture. It's really sticking or cutting and burning.
That's right.
You know, if you translated it. And in the West, the burning aspect almost doesn't exist anymore. Very few people use moxa, direct or indirect,
yes,
in a treatment process. And the sticking or cutting, in terms of the depth, as well as the forms of needles, most people do not know that there are 9 methods. There are 12 different kinds of needles. There are 5 different depths.
That's right.
In terms of dealing with that, based on specific problems. Each of them had to do with a specific pathological and physiological process. And then there were the different forms of the needles that would fit those processes. But in terms of...
But what was really confusing for me is when I get to realize, you know, that there is such a problem with the word of acupuncture. There was still some problem. There might be a big problem with translation. So if we are not like you, that you were in a lineage with Dr. So,
mm-hmm.
or you basically know traditional Chinese language, that there are people that might not understand what was the classical Chinese medicine about, and they are doing books about it, and concept and methods, and it's not really close, you know.
Yeah, well, we have to remember, I mean, there's a couple of things that happen in every scientific discipline. It doesn't matter whether it's medicine or physics, that over the period of time, there become different cultural influences that change the way in which people understand the material as well as the way in which they use it. That's first. Secondly, traditionally or historically in China, in terms of philosophy as well as in terms of science, there's always been this dichotomy, this tension between the spiritual and the material. Now, both of those have been presented. In fact, there are two famous brothers, one who was very much into the spiritual aspects of Chinese thought and medicine and reality, and others very much in terms of the material. And they both wrote, and they were both, you know, they're diametrically opposite. But that's normal. You know, that's a process that we see in every culture.
Mm-hmm.
The question is, well, was for me at the moment, when I started learning from Dr. So, I didn't understand any of that. You know, it didn't mean anything to me. None of that did.
Yeah.
Because
you didn't have this cultural background, right?
Well, not just that, because I didn't have the experience in terms of treatment that would enable me to say, oh, yeah, that's more this or that's more that.
Okay.
Didn't know. But when he treated me, and I realized that something happened that was more than just the material reaction of my body to the needle that he stuck into an acupuncture point, that something else was going on, that just opened up a whole new awareness and a desire to become familiar with what is this stuff? What's behind that? What's really going on here? And that's when I started digging and started pushing him to tell me what was happening. Because his experience was, for the most part, people weren't interested. They were interested in points for headaches, points for stomach aches, points to the, what points do you use for this and this and this? And the whole
That's
diagnostic
right.
process, the thinking behind it, the ability to be creative in terms of the way in which you develop treatment processes, the inclusion of other aspects, how you use moxa differently. For most of our students, unfortunately, they weren't interested. That was very disappointing for him. Because, you know, like he said, I will give you everything. You know, just ask me. Just ask me, you know.
And read the classics.
Right. That's right. You have to read the old books. This is what he always said. Read the old books. And that was very hard because that meant that for him, I mean, he began until he realized that I was serious, that I, you know, I really wanted to know. He had almost given up, not on teaching, but on expecting to be able to pass on the knowledge, experience, information that he had gained.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, so that's, I mean, I would not be, I am not critical of people who don't teach those other aspects or who write books based on their own experience or based on their knowledge. You know, it doesn't bother me. What bothers me is when someone says this is the truth. You know,
yeah,
this is the
of
whole
course.
picture.
That's right.
Everything else is, I mean, I don't know the whole picture. I've been doing this for over 52 years. Sometimes I think I'm just, you know, at the beginning. But it's like what is in the class. The acupuncture is very easy to learn. It's very difficult to master. And that mastery depends on what your level of understanding is, because what my students in beginners courses do today took me 5 years experience to get to that point. You know, so in terms of the development, that stuff changes, you know, over a period of time. And for people to write based on where they are today, I think it's important. It helps them to concretize their experience, the information, to be able to reflect differently about what's going on. Whether it's the truth, whether it's the whole truth and nothing but the truth, that's something else. You know, that's a different story.
Yeah, it was really something when I saw you first time, when I saw you work, when I saw you how it was even sometimes during one treatment, one needle or two needles punctured into the patient's body, and how it instantly changed the way they looked, for example. I remember my patient that I came with to Krakow. And I think up till this time, she is thinking about you and about this treatment, because I saw how her face changed, how the edema went down, how the smile went up and colors and, you know, everything. And the way you work with the needle, you manipulate the needle, you go with the needle on the different levels, but also this energetic work that you do. And this is my other question, this method that you also taught me, the Pink Shen method. Can you say something more about it?
Well, basically, there's a quote. Wait, let me see if I can find it quickly. There's a quote in the Su Wen that the highest form of treatment is to be one with the patient. Let me see
That's
if I
right.
can find
Yeah,
it.
yeah, yeah. This is the one.
Yeah, I just want to get to it. Give me a second and I'll be there.
Okay.
Okay. Okay, so in the 13th chapter of the Su Wen. And it says that the highest form of treatment is in being one with the patient. And, you know, that's depending on your own development, that can be interpreted differently. Sometimes people means being in an empathetic relationship with the patient. Sometimes people think that it means being in the same process, being present mentally with the patient. What is meant by that, what is originally meant by that in terms of the way in which it's written, in terms of the characters that he used, is that there is a fusion or a coming together of your Shen, of the aspects, you know, that compromises with that of the patient. So there is a unification. The patient is then, if you will, in your heart space. Okay. The reality of it is that we're all in each other's mind space all the time, but our awareness is not such that we're aware of that. And what the Ping Shen method is, what the or the Tong Shen Ming method is, it's a medical aspect of what's called the way of the heart in Chinese medicine or Chinese philosophy. It's a discipline, it's the internal discipline, and it enables the practitioner to be in a place of no intent, of being present, of manifesting Wu Wei in that sense. I mean, there are other levels where you then are more active, but the first is by doing that, by really being in contact with that one with your own heart as a emperor. You develop a different, if you will, a different presence. You are available differently to the life around you in a manner that enables you to be aware of the presence of the patient in a different manner. What happens is that your Shen and his Shen, if you will, they flow into each other in a manner that
For
is.
the people that doesn't know Chinese terms, Shen, you mean what by Shen?
Well, see, that's the problem. Translating Shen in terms of English, you get into fights with sinologists.
Okay.
Shen is interpreted as being spirit. In terms of Chinese medicine, there are different ways in which it manifests itself in the human body. That's why they say that each organ has its own Shen. It's not true. Each organ has its own way of manifesting the Shen that exists. But basically, it is the divine. It is the divine presence or manifest in your person. Okay. Our access to that happens at a level that allows that then to manifest itself. And what happens is when you're in that place, when you're in that state, in terms of the basic approach, then those around you feel calm. They feel they have the feeling of being safe. They have the feeling of being in touch with sometimes with an aspect of themselves that they weren't aware of. They don't see it as you doing it, but it's like if you have a swimming pool and I jump in the swimming pool and it causes waves. Okay. When I stop moving, the waves stop moving after a while. Somebody else jumps in the swimming pool and causes waves, but if I still don't move, those waves stop quicker. And what happens is that based on the fact that I am not moving, my heart is not creating more waves, then the communication or the awareness that I have of different aspects of the patient's person becomes sharper. I can, when I feel the pulse, it's more exact. When I look to see what happens in me when I work with them, because this happens in me, it's my heart space, then I can see whether what I'm doing has the desired effect or not. It gives me the ability to experience more clearly the flow of qi and blood in the patient's body during the treatment process at different levels.
When we had our last talk via Zoom, you told me something about it that really opened my mind, because in many times I'm overthinking stuff, and this is our Western way, to go here, right? isn't the, this is what I thought just right in the moment, but when you go to the heart, you are more going into the place of emotions and intuition. Is it true or
No,
that's
it's
not
behind
exact?
that. It's behind that.
Okay.
It enables you to experience the emotions and be more intuitive, but it's coming from a place of authenticness. It's coming from a place where you are really rooted and connected with the absolute, however you want to define the absolute. And being in that place enables you then to see and experience things differently. It affects everything you do. You know, when you bake bread, the bread tastes different if you're there, if you're not here. This is ego. This is my generals. These are the guys that want to solve problems, you know, win wars, whatever. The heart is not about that in its absolute sense. The heart is about nourishing, presence, supporting, you know, and being aware of and experiencing the life around us in an accepting, non-judgmental manner. And that's
are you in this state all the time, or are you in this state only in practice? Is it, you know, you got too used to it?
In the beginning, I was in this state only in practice, but when I started, that took a while to understand that that was the case. But I meditate as well. And the meditation that I do is a heart-based meditation that refines. That's not its intent, but the effect is that it also refines the work, the Ping Shen work that I do, the work with patients at the level of the heart. And I try to maintain that state all the time, but you know, I'm only human. I don't get it. It doesn't happen. You know, things happen, and I'm not there anymore. I'm not as deeper, deep. I am constantly deeper than I was. There's no question about that. But I'm not at the place where I am when I meditate, for example, or when I do my own exercises. I'm not there 24 hours, seven days a week, even though I would, that's my goal. You know, my goal is to be in permanent fusion with the highest in me, in permanent fusion with the absolute. Because I see that as the goal of life. I mean, that's, you know, we call it going home in a certain manner. But no, to answer your question, honestly, no, I am not there all the time. I'm almost always there when I treat, even though I'm not treating anymore at the moment. And when I teach, and I try to be, when I catch myself not being there, I try to take a step back and get back in touch. But, you know, like I said, I'm human. I'm not always there.
Yeah, of course. I think it might be hard to be there all the time, or even in the practice, when you have some other stuff going on in your head or in your life. You know, or for example, you are tired or something like this. I mean, I can say about myself that sometimes it's just too hard. But
Well, that's why it's
it's
important
like,
to be gentle with yourself.
yeah.
Because when you try hard to be there, it doesn't work. You know, it's something that doesn't work with effort. Wu Wei is not about effort. Wu Wei is about not doing. And that's what's difficult, because when I stop doing, when I'm just present, my brain tries to kill me. You know, it's like, wait, well, we got to do this. We have to do this. We have to do this. And it's like, stop. And then it's okay.
Okay. My last question is about the integration of the systems. And when we start to talk right now, I realize that it's a hard one. I mean, integration of Western and Chinese system. And in terms of, I think, herbal system, the TCM one was a pretty good one to integrate it with the Western one. But in terms of acupuncture, the TCM acupuncture, you know, was so-so. And the classical one, with all this stuff that we talk about even right now, which is like, you know, like a percent of the stuff that is right there, it's pretty difficult to integrate, right?
Well, I don't know. It depends on what your expectations are. What you mean by integration?
By
if it's
integration, by integration, I mean that that we would have to find a common ground of a sort of a language that both Chinese practitioners and Western practitioners understand each other. So they are speaking the same, not only in terms of acupuncture, in terms of energetic channels or acupoints, but even about the state of the patient, right? Because when the Chinese practitioner says something about some meridian not working right, or phlegm, or, you know, fire or so on, for Western practitioner or for the patient in the West, it means nothing or even worse.
Well, short answer is the integration usually implies a peer relationship, an equal partnership between two aspects where both have the same value, both have the same. Okay, that's one thing.
No one loses. No one loses.
Yeah, in that sense, it's a no-lose situation. But in the West, that's not something that is happening in terms of Chinese medicine. It doesn't matter which form we're talking about. What we see is the attempt or the challenge that Western human physicians, or Western physicians, human medicine, are faced with in terms of learning acupuncture and applying it, or herbal medicine and applying it in their practice. And usually they do it parallel. You know, they have their Western medical or school medicine approach, and then they have a way in which they deal with issues with Chinese medicine. So they integrate it in their practice. They have some patients, they do more herbal and acupuncture, some they do more Western pharmaceutical or manipulation or whatever. That the integration happens in the person itself. And the problem in terms of communicating between different systems, between different practitioners that practice different systems, is if they don't understand the language of the other, it doesn't happen. If I'm not familiar with what is meant by high blood pressure, for example, and I know that blazing liver fire is one, in some ways, can manifest itself as high blood pressure. It's not only that, but
that's right.
If I know that, then it's easier for me to decode what my colleague is saying, and to explain to them in a manner that is helpful, that what I am trying to do is to reduce the dynamic that is responsible for the high blood pressure.
That's right.
Okay. But at least one of us has to be bilingual, has to understand both languages.
That's right.
Because otherwise what happens is what we see in the West, you have different forms of acupuncture, not the systems that you've talked about, but you have a French style, you have a English style, you have an American osteopathic style, you have an American chiropractic style, you have, those are aspects of, those were attempts to integrate acupuncture in Chinese, in Western medicine, where Western medicine played the central role, or Western medical approaches played the central role, and they tried to introduce aspects of the techniques and the thinking of acupuncture into those. So it was not an equal partnership in that sense, first of all. And most integrative discussions do not see them as being equal partnership. They see the Western medicine as being central and primary.
Yeah, because it depends. This is a good idea. What you are talking about, because this is also the thing that I'm mainly thinking about, mostly every day.
Mm-hmm.
Because one thing is Western medicine, and the other thing is what is proposed from chiropractors, physical therapists, and osteopaths. Mm-hmm. They are thinking something else. I think something in between Western medicine and Chinese medicine. And when I started to learn osteopathy, I realized how important is anatomy and physiology. And in these terms, this is for now, I'm thinking that this is the common ground, even though it's more Western, because it's hard to find ourselves. I mean, I'm speaking in terms of me and people, I think, from the West, on the ground of Chinese medicine, I mean, on the energetic level, because for us is, there is no, structural base there. There is a belief that we have to hang on.
Or an experience.
Yes, that's right. You are right.
See, that's the difference. If people experience those different aspects, if they experience those different levels, if they experience those different qualities, then it's not an issue.
Okay.
Yeah. The problem is that, human beings are stubborn. We learn something, we spend a long time learning something, and we're told that's it. And so we fight with that for a while to try and make that work and integrate that in a certain manner. And are resistant to opening up to something else until we figure out what that's about. We go through the thought process before we go through the experiential process. In the non-European world, which is the majority part of the world, in the non-Western
right.
world, which is the majority part of the world, it's the other way around. It's the experience is what's important, and the theoretical base, the foundation, the model that we use to explain it comes based on, to some extent, what we're taught, but what we experience.
Mm-hmm.
So it's easier to consider doing two or three different things parallel. It's not integration in the sense that one or the other disappears completely, or one or the other is subordinate to the other. It's a matter of being able to work with more than one system, and decide based on where the patient's at and my own competence, which of these systems is more appropriate.
Okay.
See, I think that's where the future comes from. But that means that people have to have, in terms of non-European medicine, have to have a background that allows them to see the patient wholly from a non-European point of view. And if you're talking about Chinese medicine, classical Chinese medicine, acupuncture, that's part of the struggle that most students have in terms of letting go of the model that they've learned based on how they earn their daily money in their practice, and understanding what just happened when somebody stuck a needle in them at the level of heaven and things changed. They try to figure out, well, what nerves are involved in that? Wrong model. Doesn't have anything to do with that. So that's one of the things we have to get over. And because of our cultural biases or prejudice, or however you want to talk about it, that's very difficult for people. Not because they have a bad idea of who Asians or non-Europeans are, but because we are ethnocentric as human beings. We have our own culture. We identify ourselves based on values and cultural systems that we've learned and we lived in. And to consider opening up to something else and allowing that to expand, and to give up some of the things which I thought I was 100% sure of, is very, very difficult. You know, and that happens at the level of the heart, by the way. When that happens at the level of the heart. And then it's amazing. You see people change in ways that they don't even understand, but that, you know, it's a beautiful smile that you see on someone's face when you're treating them and you're really in contact. You know, you're really in contact with your own heart during the whole treatment. You see the change, in, as you said, in their face, in their attitude. Doesn't have anything to do with their thought process. Doesn't have anything to do with their expectations. And it's especially beautiful to see with patients who have been treated in other systems, and they are on the point of giving up, you know, because nothing seems to work, and you're sort of like the last hope. And you start treating them, and they go, yeah. And that yeah is not because the goal of the treatment is that they relax. The yeah is because their system begins to communicate with itself differently. Yeah. That's what we call health in Chinese medicine, when their communication is open, flowing, unhindered, rejuvenating. Yeah. That's what our goal is. And it doesn't matter if you can do that by playing the trumpet, that's what's appropriate, you know. So integration happens, for me, happens in the practitioner.
Okay.
Yeah. There is a reason why people want to see it happen between systems, because we have propriety attitudes towards systems. That's my system. That's your system.
That's right. That's right. Ego.
Right. And that's all right. If that's where people are, you know, that's fine. Doesn't bother me. But I know that if someone wants, and I have students that do that very well, they have, you know, they have a good foundation in classical acupuncture, and they are Western medical professionals, and they are able to, based on how they experience here, their patient, to make a decision what is at what moment appropriate, a more Western approach or an approach to Chinese. All right.
This is a good one. Okay.
Without the need to change one or the other, because both systems, both paradigms work.
Okay.
You know, if it works, don't fix. Why would I want to change it? I can make it work better. How? I have to understand the system in terms of making it work better. If I don't understand the system, I can't make it work better. You know, it's like, all right, so I run around in circles trying to figure out how to get these two things to get work together so I've got something better. No. What's important is that you end up at a place where you are more capable of making a decision which aspect of what you've learned, of your clinical approaches, of your diagnostic approaches, what is more appropriate for the patient at that moment.
Okay,
based on your confidence.
If I can just touch this topic, because this is the first thing that came into my mind. When the patient comes to your practice, and you have lots of experience, and sometimes you do the pulse, do the whole diagnostic, and at some point you think, okay, there is some process going on in the body that I don't like, right? Mm-hmm. That is, I'm not sure what it is, but it's serious, and this is more for this person should go to check himself, herself to the Western doctor to see what is going on, right?
Yep.
In terms of diagnostics.
Okay. Do it all the time.
Okay.
Do it all the time. Because like I said, I don't know the truth. You know, if the truth is absolute, then knowing it means that you have absolute truth. I don't have it. You know, I get impressions, I get attitudes, I get feelings, I get ideas. Based on the diagnostic information I have of treatment approaches that are based on treatment principles, which are based on that information. But you know, the human body, the humans, it's a dynamic process.
Yeah.
You know, so it's always possible that there's something developing or something process that hasn't manifested itself yet at a level where I can experience it to include it in my treatment process, or I don't get it. I can see that something else is going on and I can't put it into place for whatever reason. You know, I don't beat myself up anymore about that. You know, it is when it's that way, it's that way. And if I feel it's necessary or helpful, hold on, what was that? Oh, yeah. Necessary or helpful, definitely send them to a Western physician. And in Germany, all my patients have seen a Western physician either before or during the time that I'm treating them, now, oftentimes afterwards as well, you know, to follow up. I've had patients sent to me in terms of pre-operation preparation, you know, in terms of cancer patients, or in terms of patients that had other problems like Parkinson's or MS, multiple sclerosis. And in terms of documenting that, because it's sometimes important for their insurance or the continued work with the physician, which I don't try to substitute. You know, I don't try to take their place. It's important for them to be able to see the progress. And if there's no progress, it's important for them to see that as well. You know, and to ask the questions, well, what's going on here? You know, patient says that they're feeling better, but this hasn't changed. This is, you know, and then we talk about that. You know, so you develop a level of communication that is not based on the medical terminology that you would use to describe pathological or physiological processes. Rather, it's based on the well-being of the patient, where the patient is at in that process. For me, that's integration. It's just like integrating someone in a community does not mean all of a sudden they become white or black or green or purple. It means that they live their life in a community as a valued a member of that community, you know, equal with the other members of the community. And that's, for me, if we talk about integrative medicine, you have to have two adults. One's called Chinese medicine, the other's called Western medicine. And however they are formed, whatever their presence is, if they're able to coexist, you got it. And coexistence doesn't happen in the air, it happens in real time, in real people. So that means they have to be able to coexist in me. Well, if I'm an osteopath and I do Chinese medicine as well, then my approach is integrative. Now, if I'm a physical therapist and I do Chinese medicine or acupuncture as well, then my approach is integrative to the extent to which I master each of these different disciplines, different approaches.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And everything else for me is marketing. You know, all that other stuff is, you know, it's about people wanting to market, and you know, that's fine. You know, you can't always find a common denominator that everyone agrees on. There are common denominators that exist, but sometimes they're too simple and they're too open, and means that nobody profits financially from them or in terms of reputation. So they're not used, they're ignored. I'm gonna have to go. It's getting
yeah, yeah, yeah. I wanted to finish right now.
Yeah, but just in terms of integration, for me, integrative medicine at its best takes place in the practitioner.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for that. And we would leave it at here. And Dom, I will give in the information about your contact information, for example, your website, on the link below this movie, so people can contact you if they want. And do you have there also information about your upcoming courses and so on?
Yeah, there will be new stuff on the website. The stuff on the website right now is not actual. The courses that are will be completed in this coming year are master training courses. I mean, where I'm training advanced students to be able to train other students.
Okay.
There will be in this coming year beginners courses as well as normal advanced training courses for people that have already learned acupuncture, but also some beginners courses. But you'll see that on the website. There'll be stuff about Pingshen, there'll be stuff about needle technique, about point location.
Super.
All right.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. I appreciate it. It's good talking to you. A long time since we just
Yeah,
had a chance to talk.
that's right.
All right.
I really miss that. Bye, Don.
Oh, we have to make some courses happen in Poland that we can do it regularly.
That's right. We will
Okay.
do it. Bye
Bye
bye.
now.